a very useful data source is compiled files. This allows our pipeline to benefit from the sophisticated processing performed by each language's compiler. Thus, we don't need to reinvent the wheel by devising our own lexical analysis and parsing tools. Instead, we can obtain the processed source code data in the canonical form in which the compiler digests it. Many types of data files are amenable to this kind of processing. These include native code object files, virtual machine bytecode files, linked executable files, as well as statically and dynamically linked libraries. This approach works on many environments, for example, for native code on Unix and Windows, and in the Java ecosystem. We can see what's in the native code object files with the nm command.
Here is a very simple C program called hello.c. It includes a header, it defines a global variable named global and a static variable named local, which is only visible within the file. There is also a local function named localfun and a main function which is globally visible. Main calls the printf function to print on the standard output hello world. Next to hello world, it prints the output of localfun. I compile the file hello.c with the cc command, which stands for C compiler. Next, I run the nm command, which stands for names or name list. I use it on the object file to see the symbols located in it. Nm outputs a list of addresses, the type of each symbol, and then symbol name. Nm uses capital letters to denote the types of global elements. As we can see, the first symbol of hello.o is a globally undefined symbol, printf. Then there is a global symbol named global, which is of type capital C. C stands for common area. It's the way global variables are defined in C. The name is a remnant from old Fortran programs, a computer language developed in the 1950s and still in use for scientific computing. After global, there is local, a symbol that corresponds to an uninitialized local function. Its type, lowercase b, stands for block starting with symbol. In this way, local identifies a block that is initialized to plain zeros. The following lowercase t symbol stands for text, which denotes code. It refers to the local function localfun. Furthermore, we have another capital T symbol for the global function main. The last symbol here is another unidentified one, stdout.
We can also use the nm command on some executable files.
I compile again hello.c, but this time to an executable program instead of an object file. Running nm on the executable program hello, we get many more symbols now. That's because the program I wrote has been compiled and linked against the C library. For example, we see a capital B symbol, block starting symbol, BSS start, for the beginning address of all C uninitialized variables. Executable programs do not need their symbols to run. With a command called strip, we can remove all symbols from an executable program. In this way, I strip hello from its symbols. To verify that, I run nm again on hello, and we get a warning that hello contains no symbols. Production systems are often shipped with the symbols stripped in order to save disk space or prevent reverse engineering. For instance, if I run nm on binls, we see that there are no symbols available.
As a complete example, let's now use the nm command to find which source code files contain the most global variables.
I build this command step by step on a directory containing all the compiled object files of the Apache web server. As a first step, I run nm with the minus o option, which means to precede each symbol with the file name where it occurs. I add as arguments to nm the output of the find command. Find searches in the current directory hierarchy for files ending with the suffix .o. These are the object files. Then, for each symbol found in the object files, nm outputs the file name, the symbol type, and its name. This was the first step in finding the file with the most global variables. As a second step, I filter the output of nm to only list the uninitialized global data definitions. To do that, I pipe the output of an M to grep capital D, which represents the uninitialized global variables. Indeed, we now see symbols such as dir module, action module, and auth module. As a third step, I run again my pipeline, but now I want to isolate the file names. I use the cut command with a minus D option to specify as the field separator the colon character. The file name is the first field, so I also specify that with a minus F option. As a result, we get a list of file names, mod dir, mod actions, and so on. The final step involves sorting the file names by the number of their global variables. I run again the pipeline, I pipe the output to sort in order to group the file names together. Then I run unique -c to count the occurrences of each distinct file name. Finally, I sort the file names in reverse numerical order. We see that HTTP main contains the most global variables, 37, quite a small number. The following files contain either one or two variables each.
On Unix and on Windows, most executable files are linked with dynamically linked libraries, also known as shared libraries. This allows the libraries to change independently of the programs that are linked to, and also to save some disk space. Let's see how we can find information about which libraries are linked to which programs.
I run the ldd command on binls to list all dynamically linked libraries. As an output for each library, we get the corresponding system file it resolves to. To find the most used dynamic libraries, I first run ldd on all executable files in the bin directory. Then I pipe the output to sed to get rid of the left-hand side libraries of the above list. I only want to keep the system files the libraries resolve to. These are the right-hand side parts of the list. Similar to the previous example, I run sort to group the libraries together. Then I pipe the output to unique -c to count the occurrences and sort the libraries in reverse numerical order. With head, we see the top 10 used libraries. Three libraries share the first place: the Linux Virtual Dynamic Shared Object Library, VDSO, the C Standard Library, and the Dynamic Linker Library. These are used by all programs. The following libraries are used fewer times, as we can see.
In the Java ecosystem, we can use the javap command to look into Java class files.
Running javap on a jar file and specifying the file to a class, we get the way this class is defined. The -c and -p arguments of javap are used to disassemble the file and list the class's private members. As we can see, the output of javap is much more detailed than the output of nm. That's because by default, Java class files contain more information than compiled C programs.
On Windows, we can use the dump bin command in order to examine native code files.
As an example, let's change to the Windows directory and use dump bin to see what the notepad program imports. I run dump bin on the file notepad.exe, specifying as an argument slash imports. On Windows, arguments are specified with a slash rather than a minus. We see that Notepad imports various functions such as registry set value and registry query value. Furthermore, we can use the dump bin command to see what a DLL exports. I change to the system32 directory where many DLLs are stored. There, I run dump bin on wsoc32.dll, the Windows socket implementation. By specifying the slash exports argument, we see that it exports various functions such as accept and the num protocols.
This concludes our unit on fetching data from compiled code. Stay with us.